Dietary fiber is a mixture of complex organic substances, including hydrophilic compounds such as soluble and insoluble polysaccharides and non-digestible oligosaccharides, as well as a range of less hydrophobic compounds such as chitins, submarins, and lignins. In this video, we describe the Prosky method, AOAC method 985.29, for the measurement of total dietary fiber. This method developed as the result of research by several laboratories in Europe and America. The basic aim of the method was to measure high molecular weight non-digestible polysaccharides such as cellulose, beta-glucan, rhabnoxylin, mannans, pectins, etc. Historically, the method, as described in the Megazyme Total Dietary Fiber booklet, Method 2, and as detailed in this video, has been called total dietary fiber. But in fact, it is only a measure of the polysaccharide fraction. This would be better termed Prosky fiber, as it is a consequence of the method employed. This Prosky method was developed in the 1980s and was actually used to develop the then definition of dietary fiber. Since that time, the importance of resistant starch and non-digestible oligosaccharides as dietary fiber components have been recognized, and these have been incorporated into the dietary fiber definition published by Codex Alimentarius in 2009. In fact, only high molecular weight polysaccharides, including those that are water insoluble and those that precipitate from solution in 80% ethanol, are measured by the Prosky method. Non-digestible oligosaccharides are not measured at all, and incorrect values are obtained for resistant starch. In many cases, the dietary fiber values obtained with the Prosky method are adequate, and for this reason, the Prosky method is widely used. This video tutorial will demonstrate the use of this method with various sample types, along with assay blanks. The kit comes in various sizes, containing sufficient reagents for 100 or 200 assays, and is supplied with a detailed data booklet. The principle of the Prosky method for the measurement of dietary fiber is outlined in this figure. Samples are treated with a thermostable alpha amylase for 30 minutes, 95 to 98 degrees Celsius, during which starch is hydrolyzed. Protein in the sample is hydrolyzed by the incubation with protease for 30 minutes at 60 degrees Celsius. Amaltodextrins are hydrolyzed by incubation with amyloglucosidase for a further 30 minutes. This process of enzymatic incubations hydrolyzes proteins and starch from the sample, mimicking digestion. Samples are then treated with 4 volumes of ethanol, or IMS, to precipitate high molecular weight soluble dietary fiber, and then filtered and washed with aqueous ethanol, ethanol and acetone, to remove hydrolyzed starch and protein and lipids. Samples are incubated in duplicate, and the residue weights are measured and recorded. One residue is then analyzed for ash content, and the second is analyzed for residual protein. Both of these weights are subtracted from residue weights to give the value for dietary fiber. Please see our video on the preparation of fritted crucibles with sea light filter beds for dietary fiber analysis for details on how to prepare the crucibles for dietary fiber sample analysis. Mill the sample to pass a 0.5mm screen. Dietary fiber should be determined on an as-is basis on dried, fat-free samples. Dry the samples overnight in a vacuum oven at 70 degrees Celsius or in a forced air oven at 103 degrees Celsius. On removing the samples from the oven, transfer them to a desiccator and allow them to cool to room temperature. Alternatively, analyze the samples as is and separately determine moisture content and allow for this in the final values. For samples with the fat content above 10% weight per weight, defat these with petroleum ether according to the booklet, or alternatively defat using an Ancom XT15 extractor. Prior to sample analysis, prepare the required additional reagents as described in the kit data booklet. All of the kit components, alpha amylase, protease, and amyloglucosidase, are supplied as ready-to-use solutions. Weigh 1 gram of the sample correct to 0.1 milligram into 250 milliliter Fisher brand glass bottles. Alternatively, 400 milliliter tall form beakers can be used. To each bottle, add a 7 by 30 millimeter stirrer bar. Add 50 milliliters of phosphate buffer pH 6 to each bottle. With each assay, two blanks should be run along with samples to measure any contribution from reagents to residues and should be included in all processes. Check that the pH is approximately 6 plus or minus 0.1. To prevent lump formation, stir on a magnetic stirrer until sample is completely dispersed in solution. Add 0.05 milliliters of heat-stable alpha amylase, bottle 1, while stirring at low speed. Cap the bottles and place into a water bath at 98 to 100 degrees Celsius and incubate for 30 minutes with continuous agitation. Swirl the bottle contents at 5-minute intervals over the 30-minute incubation period. Use a thermometer to check the temperature. It is essential that the contents of the bottles are at approximately 100 degrees Celsius for at least 15 minutes. Remove the bottles from the boiling water bath and allow them to cool to room temperature. Adjust the pH of the solutions to a pH of approximately 7.5. by adding 10 milliliters of 0.275 normality sodium hydroxide to each bottle. Check the pH with a pH meter. Add 100 microliters of protease solution, bottle 2, to each sample. Start the timer when the temperature of the water bath reaches 60 degrees Celsius. Cap the bottles and incubate in a stirring water bath at 60 degrees Celsius plus or minus 1 degree, with continuous agitation for 30 minutes. Alternatively, incubate the bottles in a shaking water bath set in orbital motion at 60 degrees Celsius. Remove the bottles from the water bath and allow to sit at room temperature for 10 minutes. Add 10 milliliters of 0.325 normality hydrochloric acid solution to adjust the pH to 4.5 plus or minus 0.2 and check with a pH meter. Incubate the bottles in a stirring water bath at 60 degrees Celsius. Add 0.2 milliliters of amyloglucosidase solution, bottle 3, while stirring on a magnetic stirrer. Replace the lid. Incubate at 60 degrees Celsius for 30 minutes with constant agitation. Start timing when the temperature of the water bath reaches 60 degrees Celsius. Alternatively, incubate the bottles in a shaking water bath set in orbital motion at 60 degrees Celsius. To each sample, add 4 volumes of 95% ethanol, which has been measured at room temperature and subsequently preheated to 60 degrees Celsius. Cap all samples and mix thoroughly. Allow the precipitate to form at room temperature over 60 minutes. However, if required from a time standpoint, it can be left to sit overnight. weigh the crucibles containing the zeolite to the nearest 0.1 mg on an analytical balance. Wet and redistribute the zeolite in the crucible using approximately 15 milliliters of 78% volume per volume ethanol from a wash bottle over a Büttner flask labeled as waste. Apply suction to distribute the zeolite as an even mat on the crucible. Do this for each crucible. Transfer the crucible from the waste Büttner to the sample Büttner and apply a vacuum to the flask. Decant some of the supernatant solution from the sample into a beaker, then apply the rest of the precipitated TDF suspension to the crucible. Use the decanted solution to rinse any remaining sample from the sample bottle. And use the rubber policeman spatula to dislodge sample from the sides of the incubation bottle. Apply this solution to the crucible. Filter the suspension under vacuum and recover the TDF residue in the crucible. Using a wash bottle with 78% ethanol and a rubber spatula, quantitatively transfer all remaining particles to the crucible. The high molecular weight dietary fiber content is retained in the crucible. This filtrate is not used in AOAC method 985.29. However, with a slight modification to this method, the filtrate at this point could be concentrated, desalted and analysed by HPLC for resistant maltodextrins and other SDFS for AOAC method 2001.03, the Matsutani method. To be able to perform this analysis, the enzymes employed must be free of glycerol, as glycerol is used as an internal standard in AOAC method 2001.03. Wash the sample with 3 20 ml portions of 78% ethanol, followed by 2 10 ml portions of 95% ethanol, and finally with 2 10 ml portions of acetone. Leave the samples on the Büttner until the smell of acetone can no longer be detected in the residues. Loosely cover the crucibles containing the TDF residue with aluminium foil and dry these at 105 degrees Celsius overnight in a hot air oven. Transfer the crucibles from the oven to a desiccator and allow it to cool over 1 hour. Weigh the crucibles correct to the nearest 0.1 mg and record this weight. Use this weight to calculate residue mass by subtracting the tear weight, which is the weight of the dried crucible plus zeolite. One residue from each type of fibre is analysed for protein, and the second residue of the duplicate is analysed for ash. Determine protein and ash weight in grams. Protein analysis is performed using Kjeldahl or combustion methods. Ash analysis is determined by incinerating the second residue for 5 hours at 525 degrees Celsius. This residue weight is corrected for protein, ash and the blank value for the final calculation of TDF as high molecular weight dietary fiber. Calculations of dietary fiber can be performed as detailed in the kit data booklet, or the calculations can be significantly simplified using the Excel-based MegaCalc application specific to this total dietary fiber assay kit, which is available to download free of charge from the Megazyme website. The MegaCalc spreadsheet provides full instructions for use. Open the MegaCalc worksheet and input the following. Sample details. Insert the sample identifier. Insert the recorded sample weight in grams, correct to the nearest 0.1 mg. Insert the residue weight R1 and R2 for the sample on the blank BR1 and BR2. Residue mass is calculated by subtracting the crucible plus sea light tear weight from the dried and cooled crucible containing dietary fibre residue plus sea light. Insert the protein weight P for the sample and blank BP in grams. Insert the ash mass A for the sample and blank BA in grams. When this data is entered, the content of dietary fibre in the sample is automatically calculated and given as percent weight per weight. Further information on the importance of enzyme purity for the measurement of dietary fibre is discussed in detail in a paper by McCleary. Information on the collaborative study for this method is available from the AOAC.